我们的小组讨论依然还是分为三个部分。第一个部分我会给大家提一个问题，然后会要求大家依次作答。第二个部分呢，就是大家针对这个问题，可以有一些自己想说的，想表达的东西都 OK。一方面呢，你可以补充你自己刚才没有提到的一些点；另一方面呢，你也可以，或许你对其他同学的回答比较感兴趣，你也可以继续提出问题，或者跟他进行深度的讨论和交流。主要就是希望大家在这个部分可以轻松快乐的多多的练习英语口语。那么第三个部分呢，就是我会针对大家第一个部分的回答提出一些建议与意见，然后希望可以帮助大家在下一次的口语练习当中有所提升。OK，那我们就准备开始今天的练习吧。OK，for today's question, the question is, what is computational advertising? I will repeat the question again. What is computational advertising? Okay, then you may have 1 minute to think about this question, and then I will ask you guys to answer this question one by one, okay? Okay, may I have 2427B?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Now I will begin.
Okay.
Computational advertising is based on the development of technology. So there is more and more data consists of our smart device usage. And with this background, the computational advertising comes into our life. First of all, computational advertising is that using some technology just like big data to reconstruct the whole activity of traditional advertising, such as in the pre in the pre analyze for your consumer, you can use the technology to big data to draw the image of your consumer, and you can get more precise traits of your consumer. Secondly, in the message posing, in message posing, you can use the individual algorithm to post some more individual message to your consumer, and it will improve the efficiency of your advertisement. Last but not least, you can use the you can use the smart technology and the big data to precisely test the effect of your advertisement, so you can so it's of great significance for evaluating the effect. That's all, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's move on to next one. 2406B.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Computational advertising is a kind of advertisement based on the big data and using some advanced technology to hand out the advertisement. And this kind of advertisement shows a lot of characteristics. First of all, it's based on some advanced technology, and you will let the advertisement more personal, more individual. And secondly, and it also collected a lot of the individual portrait. So, and you will know more about some personal preferences. And thirdly, you also use a lot of algorithm. So you will let the advertisement to hand out more directly. And this kind of advertising and has a lot of advantages. And first of all, you will, and that's the advertisement be more individual and has more has a better effect. And secondly, you will let the process of advertising be more simple, and because it uses a lot of technology, and it can save the energy of some and of the individuals. And but on the other hand, it also has some drawbacks. And first of all, because it is so relied on the data or so relied on the technology, and sometimes you will lack on some emotional consideration or some other effects that only human beings can think about that. And secondly, and some consumers or some users will feel so uncomfortable if they receive this kind of an advertising, such as at the moments on the WeChat, there is a lot of this kind of computational advertising, but sometimes they are quite rude. And although they are based on the individual algorithm, that the individual feels so uncomfortable. and they were dead and didn't want to read it or accept it. And that's all for my answer. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Let's move on to the next one. 朱家诺.
Hi, can you help me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Thanks for your kind question. In my opinion, computational advertising is an intelligent market based on big data algorithm, and it is put user on center, which carries out user things purchase under the real time and efficient calculation of data, and rapidly diverse accurately matches and optimize a series of user needs. In my opinion, I think computational advertising, it is not only an art and a tool, but also a combination of pure emotional creativity of artistic thinking and rational digital thinking of logical algorithms. That's my answer. Thank you.
Okay, let's move on to next one. Lu Xuanzhu.
Hello, can
Hello.
You hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. In my opinion, I think computational advertisement is a modern skill that based on algorithm and accurate recommendation. It often appears on the platform media, for example, the Douyin and the Bizhan. So I think, as the saying goes, every coin has its two sides, that the computational advertisement is the same. First of all, I think it can make accurate recommendations according users' preference and needs, which can save our time in finding what we need. But on the other hand, it may involve some problems such as privacy leakage. I think we all have the same or similar experience that maybe we just talking with our friends about something, and then we turn on our smartphone, open the Taobao and Douyin, we find, wow, it recommend me the same thing. So I think, but I don't think just a bad thing. So that's all for my opinion. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Let's move on to next one. 2443B.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. Thank you for your question. I think computational advertising based on the big data, AI, and some other advanced technology. It can automatically collect the elements of advertising, fuse the advertising, and deliver them to the audience. And for the source of the advertising, I think the computer can automatically searching work. They get a large scale of information on the internet and analyze them. And they can produce the advertising automatically. For the distribution of the advertising, I think it may deliver the advertising in some certain things, such as when you watch movies or you read some books, you may receive some computational advertising. And I think for the effect of this type of advertising, it can deliver the advertising accurately, which may improve the effect of the product. But for the problem of this type of advertising, I think it may cause some unemployment of the professional workers in this field. And as the audience, we may be disturbed by advertising everywhere. And it can cause some privacy problems because the database know what I love, and I may feel I'm being spied. But I also think it has some good effects, such as for economy, it may improve the sale of the products. That's all my answer. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's move on to next one, Xue Li.
Hello, everyone. Hello, good evening, teacher. And I'd like to add some information about the computational advertising. I think it's mainly used in the real-time bidding, and maybe it's more customized, and it can provide more precise advertise to the customers. However, it reminds me that there are some setbacks. A few weeks ago, I think I have read the news that there's some mother and baby software. It recommends some bad advertised things like the pornographic advertised to the father users. But for the mother users, they didn't recommend this advertise. So I think it's it brings me to think that such computational advertising, maybe they need some more surveillance, and they need to be supervised. Not every advertise that get more clicks that should be recommended. And I think computational advertising also poses great challenge to the student and the advertising industry, because it brings the rhythmic theory into the advertising field. It needs the workers to master more knowledge about arithmetic theories were the practices. And that's all. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's move on to the next part. And in this part, you guys can have a little discuss about this topic. And we may have 5 minutes left. Okay, so who wants to be the first one?
I want to add something.
Mm-hmm.
Computation advertising is based on the big data or based on the technology. But sometimes the big data will bring some stereotype or discrimination of the human being, such as they only give some advertisements to the women, such as give the advertisements about the makeups, but they never get advertisement to the men. So it will cause some stereotype, or you will cause some discrimination, and that is one problem. And the second problem is that sometimes, and this kind of advertising and will cause some privacy problems, because it's based on the big data, and this big data is collected from the individual, and sometimes some data just show the personal privacy. And you will also need the government to put more put out more policies or put more emphasis on this kind of area. And that's all. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Who's the next one? Who's the next one?
Hello, and I highly agree with the former uses, the former speaker, and I think the computational advertising maybe will worsen the information concurrence, which is because we use the internet more, and the internet is based on the big data and the rhythmics, and I think it may limit the knowledge of the users, and even it will influence the decision made by the users, such as the mostly the purchasing decisions. And I think maybe the technology and the techniques of the arithmetic maybe need more improvement.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for your sharing. And anyone else?
Hello, I want to answer the first classmate's the second question. And I think the private leakage to some extent it doesn't matter. We can see that almost all software requires to agree to some privacy terms. Otherwise, it can't be used by us. And many of them have become an indispensable part of our lives, such as the WeChat or the TikTok. So, although we agree this term, but I think as far as now, I don't accept don't require harm by the privacy leakage. So I think maybe it's just a small problem that we can to some extent to don't pay more attention to it. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyone else?
I want to add some views about this talk. Because I major in advertising, so in my opinion, I think this technology is of great significance for us. As an advertiser, because in the past, the effect of advertising activity is hard to evaluate its effect. The budget of advertising activity may be half in every advertising activity. So I think the technology has some advantages for us, but I also agree with other classmates the view. But the technology is natural. It's depend on how people use it and how people regulate it. So to make good use of this technology, I think there must be better regulation or law about its problems, such as surveillance of the life of people, or invade the privacy of people. That's all. Thank you.
Next one.
Hello. I want to add some things about this talk. I think the appearance of computational advertising for advertisers, it can improve the efficiency and accuracy of advertising and accurately calculate the effect of advertising, save time and many costs, and maximize the benefits. For consumers, the precise push and sense matching of computing advertisement can make the advertising content more in line with the current list of consumers and improve the experience of consumers. However, it cannot be ignored that the user privacy problem of computational advertising is still to be solved, and the joint efforts of relevant subjects are needed to promote the better development of computational advertising. That's all. Thank you.
Next one.
Okay, I agree with you all, but I have to say more on the micro level. Maybe it's about my individual opinion. I think as a consumer, when I receive a computational advertising, for example, I talk with my friends about an item in the evening, and I received the computational advertising on the afternoon, maybe in my WeChat. I think my I am being supervised by the computer, so I may feel disgust about this behavior because I don't like being spied by whatever person or computers. So as a consumer, I may not purchase this product because it brings me a bad feeling. So I don't know what you guys think. Although privacy revealing is an ordinary thing in the age of internet, but I think I can't accept this behavior. So what do you guys think?
Thank you. I agree with you, your opinion partly. I think every account has two sides. We cannot ignore the advantages of this computational advertising. But in my opinion, I think in the most of time, this can carry me big convenience. Thank you.
Anyone else want to say something? Okay, if there is no one, let's move on to the last part, okay? 好，那我们就直接进入第三个部分吧。我觉得今天大家讨论的都非常的热烈，非常好啊。那我们就从第一位同学开始讲。第一位同学对这个问题的回答主要分为了两个部分。那第一个部分是简介的部分，简介的部分没有什么太多的问题啊，就是如果说在简介第一个部分说完了之后，可以加上一个你生活中遇到的例子，可能我觉得会更好。然后第二个部分呢，主要讲的是应用方面的问题。对于应用方面你讲了三个点，但是我有一个疑问，就是第二点和第三点的区别是什么？因为第一点你提到的是这个大数据对这个用户习惯的一个重新的塑造和建设吧，然后呢它就可能会提高了这个消费者就会更收到更精准的推送。那么第二点你提到的是个人算法推送个性更加个性化的信息，然后效率提升了。然后第三点提到的是大数据啊智能设备啊提升了广告它本身的效果。所以这三点其实不是都是在说这个效率的提升，就是精准度的一个提升吗？就是这三点具体的区别是什么？这里需要你下去进一步再细化一下。想一想这三点的区别是什么？如果说你后面觉得有区别，那么你就要讲清楚他们之间不同的区别是什么，就是要把第一点、第二点给它分开，不要就是说成一个大块。如果说你觉得没有太大的区别，或者是其他的你也想不到了，那么你就需要把你现在拥有的这三个点重新组织一下语言，给它就说成一个点，就它的是怎么应用的，还有什么好处就可以了，好吧？就是这个部分，第二个部分你需要下去再看，按照你自己的想法去把它再修改一下。那么第二位同学2406B 同学，2406B 同学，我觉得声音听起来非常的熟悉，好像每次都有跟我练习，所以他的框架是我个人认为比较满意的。那么具体来说，第一个部分他提到了简介没有问题，第二个部分也就是特征也没有太大问题，但是呢特征这里我觉得可以进一步细化。你说到了三个点，第一个是更加的个性化，是第一个点。第二点是就是有这个个人偏好喜好。那么第一点和第二点的区别是什么？然后第三点提到的是精准推送。这个 OK， 但是前两个的区别在体现在哪里？那么这是需要你第一个要做的事情。第二个要解决的问题就是，当你讲完特征之后，你最好可以在后面跟上一句话或者一个小小的例子，说明一下这几个点之间的区别，因为用例子去说明的话，我觉得会更清楚更清晰，听起来也会不那么的抽象，所以这个是你可以下去补充的。那么在下一个板块提到的是好处，OK， 没有问题。再下一个问题提到的是它的不好的地方，也没有问题。那你看啊，就是在你提到的不好的地方的第二点，你提到了这个朋友圈的广告，然后这样子的举例，就是我刚才提到第二个部分可以加进去的，它很简单，也很清楚，可以说明问题。所以整体来说，大家可以向这个 2406B 同学学习一下，就是分板块进行回答。可能是因为他的回答就是跟我之前讲的课的内容是一模一样的，所以我个人可能更偏向这种回答。那么这种回答有一种好处，就是第一方面呢，你永远都会有可以说的东西，简介、特征、好处、不好， 这几个地方，你至少每一个地方都可以说一句话，所以能保证了我们这个问题是肯定能答得出来的。那么第二点好处就是你在回答这个问题的时候，你不需要太多的时间去思考，哦，那我下一个部分要说什么，你就顺着这个来就可以了。那么第三个好处呢，就是整体听起来，就是我听起来也是比较清晰比较明了，逻辑这个结构都比较清楚，所以听起来也比较容易，所以这是几个好的方面。那不好的方面2406B 同学下去再改进一下啊。好，那我们再到下一位同学，朱佳诺同学。朱佳诺同学，我觉得做的非常好的一点就是，我觉得你对这个概念的介绍非常的完善，或者是还有精准。我觉得好像感觉就是，你对这个问题有非常深入的一个理解，而且理解的比较全面，而且还是英文的理解，我觉得这个非常好。那么第二个部分呢，你对他的一个介绍只是从很简单的好与不好，只是从他的具体的这个作用和他的这个意义方面来谈，没有讲到具体的内容是什么。整体上来说，你的回答呢偏短，就是可能说的不够多，这是一个小问题。那么第二个问题呢，就是虽然听起来你的回答非常的完善，但是呢，就是我有一种感觉，就是感觉好像是，我不知道，我不确定我说的对不对，如果我说错了就请你指出来，就是我感觉好像听起来像你写了一篇作文，或者是说写了一段比较成熟的文字，然后尝试的再复述出来。怎么说呢，就是听起来不像一个口语的回答。如果说本身你的口语的这个程度就是这样的，那 OK， 那我们就不改了，我们就这样继续练没关系，因为听是听得懂的，而且很准确，没有太大的问题。如果说不是，是的确好像你因为在思考的时间，因为前面同学回答的时间也比较长，可能你利用了这个时间去做一些笔记或者怎么样的话，我建议就是尽可能的去把口语练习就是做的简单一点，然后轻松一点，就让大家都能听得懂，能听得清楚。这是两个小问题你需要注意一下，好吧。下一位同学卢宣竹同学。卢宣竹同学也是分为了三个部分对这个问题做了一个回答，很好啊。第一个部分简介没有问题，第二个部分那也就是你具体讲到的好处一样的，这里可以简单的举一个例子。其实有很多例子大家都可以举，比如说大家其实刚才已经提到了，有的同学说到了朋友圈里面的呀，有的同学说到了这个淘宝上面的呀，还有这个抖音上面的，包括还有这个亚马逊呀，他们不是都会有这种类似的技术去使用嘛，所以大家都可以用来举例。那么在问题这个部分呢，OK， 这个我觉得讲的可能比好处要更好一点，因为问题这里提到了一些自己的感受，自己的一些经历，所以我觉得这个部分可能比好处的部分要更生动一些，所以下去的话要把这个好处的部分再补充一下，再完善一下，好吧。下一位同学2443B 同学。2443B 同学有一个小小的问题，就是在这个回答的时候，这个整体的框架还不是特别的明了明晰。那第一部分对他简介 OK 做了简介没有问题，那么还举了这个例子，就包括像自己看电影读书的时候，那这里其实我有一个疑问，就是读书的时候怎么会收到推送呢？是因为读的是电子书吗？还是什么？这里我有点没有 get 到啊，所以这个需要你在后面再加一句，就补充解释一下为什么，就是说你在读书的时候也会收到类似的广告，加上一到两句话解释清楚，自圆其说就可以了。那么你在讲完这些内容之后，就提到了 它有一个精准推送，然后效果提升的这样的一个优点吧。然后你讲了问题的部分，然后你又讲了好处，好处包括对于经济啊，对于一些商业的好处。那么这里第四个部分的好处和你前面说到的这个第二个部分的举例和加上后面的好处有什么区别呢？这里我觉得可以整体合并在一起，放在问题的下面，也就是说把你第二个部分的后半部分放在了第四部分的后半部分，这样子我觉得整体会比较顺畅。先说内容简介，然后说说自己的感受，自己的经历，然后说问题，最后说好处，这样子会更顺畅一点。最后一位同学雪梨，简介没有问题。在这个问题方面呢，具体举例说明了，这个很好。但是缺少的一点是什么？缺少的一点是具体指出来这个问题是什么。因为前面有的同学，提到了就是观点是什么，但是呢又没有举例。那你的问题是在于你举了例，但是呢又没有说清楚你的观点，所以你这里需要补充一下你的观点是什么。那第二部分你提到了你希望它可以被监管，那这里我觉得这是一个很好的这个想法，但是缺少的是什么，就是比如说怎么监管，或者某要怎么监管，就是你认为怎么监管，从哪些方面进行监管，可以简单的谈一谈，不用想的太复杂，就是你作为一个学生，或者你作为一个这个学者，你认为他可以从哪些方面被监管。那如果你觉得你自己的想法不够成熟，那你就下去去找找资料，然后看看别人是怎么说的，然后化作你自己的语言再把它表达出来。那么第三点提到的是一些挑战的问题，这个没有什么问题啊。那整体上来说还不错，把这个第二部分和第一部分补充完整就 OK 了。好，那么今天的问题我觉得大家回答的都很好。对于这个问题大家还有什么其他的疑问吗？如果没有疑问的话我们今天就结束啦。OK, 那我们今天就先到这里吧，大家下去继续加油，今天表现的都不错哦。OK, 拜拜，拜拜啦大家。拜。